Este es Río Rico.
The river is the boundary between two countries.
Talk about illegals on this side. Well, I was illegal on that side too.
Un pueblo mexicano fronterizo con una historia excepcional.
There was a cascade of events that these folks said, "Look at what the gringos did to us. They took away our river."
Río Rico was actually at one time kind of like a little Las Vegas.
The name that pops up in this local lore is Al Capone.
Resulta que Río Rico no siempre fue parte de México.
And there's consequences of trying to control nature. I mean, unforeseen consequences.
En 1967 se supo que la ciudad era originalmente parte de Estados Unidos. Cientos de mexicanos descubrieron con asombro que en realidad eran estadounidenses.
All the major newspapers, they all carried a story about the lost Americans. It was a big deal, because it's an unusual story.
Pero, ¿cómo pasó esto? Río Rico es un pueblo pequeño, y su población ha disminuido en los últimos años. Además, sufre de los mismos problemas que otras localidades fronterizas. Por un lado, la presencia de fuerzas policiales, y por otro, de cárteles, traficantes de personas, dinero y armas. Pero si nos fijamos en su historia, la responsable de esta confusión fronteriza fue una compañía olvidada hace mucho tiempo. A principios del siglo XX, la empresa American Rio Grande Land and Irrigation Company tenía una estación de bombeo en el lado estadounidense. Con ella tomaba agua del río y la entregaba a los agricultores locales. El río Bravo, o Río Grande en Estados Unidos, había marcado la frontera desde 1848. Sin embargo, a la compañía empezó a preocuparle que cambiara de curso. Así que en 1906 abrió un nuevo canal que dejó aisladas a 169 hectáreas de la parte sur del río. El antiguo bucle del río se secó y esa área pasó a conocerse como el Banco Horcón, con el río Rico en el medio.
Essentially, south of the river is Mexico. So 419 acres became territory of Mexico. One of the treaties they violated was the 1848 Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo that said the Rio Grande is the boundary between the two countries.
La empresa recibió una multa y tuvo que pagar daños y perjuicios a los habitantes de Banco Horcón. Pero los residentes se adaptaron bastante rápido a ser parte de México. Y en 1920 se introdujo la ley seca en los Estados Unidos.
So if you're in South Texas and want to have a beer, want to have a margarita, you can't have any on this side. There were these communities across the river. You could paddle across, you could swim across, you could walk across sometimes and indulge. Rio Rico was glad to supply the American population with as much beer and tequila and whatever they wanted. 1928, they start the construction of a bridge to go across to Rio Rico. There was a lot of advertising in the local papers about the grand opening and what was happening over there. They had casinos, they had gambling, they had drinking, the Tivoli nightclub. It had a dance floor that was the size of a basketball court. They had cockfighting, and they had bordellos. So prohibition caused the economy of Rio Rico to just boom. Newspaper headlines in 1929 talked about Eastern capitalists purchased Rio Rico to be high-class resorts. 250 of the fastest dogs in the country arrived for the inaugural race of Rio Rico Kennel Club. And the name that pops up in this local lore is Al Capone. Now, there's no official record that he was down here, but it's assumed that his captains and his sergeants and his minions were doing the stuff, and they were pumping in money to Rio Rico to develop Rio Rico into a resort area.
Pero los buenos tiempos de Rio Rico se terminaron en 1933 con el fin de la ley seca. Mike England creció del lado estadounidense del río. Para él, la frontera nunca fue algo que separara a la gente.
Growing up there on the river like I did was a kid's paradise. I got to fish and hunt every day, but there was some kids from across the river that would actually come over, and I got to know them all. And we'd fish at on our side, and of course they were invited over to our house just like they were family. They'd eat with us and whatnot. I'd also swim the river and go back south. And I got to know their family just like they got to know mine. It's kind of strange, you know, they talk about illegals on this side. Well, I guess I was illegal on that side too, but nobody cared.
Después de un tiempo, los habitantes de Río Rico fueron olvidando que alguna vez habían sido ciudadanos de Estados Unidos. Hasta 1967, cuando un profesor de geografía llamado James Hill descubrió lo que había sucedido.
He did extensive research on this area and created some well-documented maps that designated the property owners in all these 419 acres where the cut of the river was.
Esto llamó la atención del abogado Laurier McDonald, que representaba a un cliente llamado Homero Cantú, quien estaba por ser deportado de Estados Unidos. McDonald pudo probar que como su cliente había nacido en Río Rico, eso lo convertía en ciudadano estadounidense.
The U.S. Court of Appeals decides, yes, indeed, Mr. Cantú was born in U.S. territory. That's the 14th Amendment to the Constitution. If you're born within the territory of the United States, you are a citizen. So he was a citizen, having been born in Río Rico. Whoop-de-doo. That started a pandemonium for Río Rico. Another resurgence in growth in Río Rico. Everyone said, I was born in Río Rico. I was born in Río Rico. These folks came from all over Mexico. They came from Europe. They came from China. Saying, I was born in Río Rico.
Y los abogados tenían que evaluar los reclamos de quienes alegaban haber nacido en Río Rico para obtener la ciudadanía estadounidense.
We had clients who had depended upon which bedroom the baby was delivered in, because the house itself sat across the international boundary line. You have to remember, though, no one who lived there really paid any attention to that boundary, and so lots were subdivided, and there was, you know, houses were built, and it was very, very strange. There was more than one family whose house was split, and it depended on what bedroom you were born in.
Al final, Estados Unidos cedió oficialmente el Banco Orcón a México y aceptó los reclamos de unas 250 personas. La mayoría emigró a Estados Unidos y Río Rico quedó casi vacío.
My grandparents' property where the shop was is still ours. That was our sort of income. We were born in the US. When my son was growing up, he got to experience a little bit of that. I would just let him kind of be free and barefooted and sit down and play with the dirt, the hens around him, you know. People, there's still good people, there's still traditional families. Back in the day, there was a hotel there and a theater. They got to see Pedro Infante, Sara Garcia, very important artists for the Mexican histories. There was a lot of people that would commute to Rio Rico just to see those artists.
Rio Rico es un lugar tranquilo ahora. Las pocas familias que aún quedan se dedican a la agricultura. Y quienes lo visitan, por lo general, pasan de camino a la frontera.
So like a lot of people that migrated to the U.S. illegally, that was kind of their stop. It did happen there, and you know, that's part of their history as well, being so close to the river.
Con la lucha de Estados Unidos contra el narcotráfico y la inmigración ilegal, esta es ahora una de las fronteras más vigiladas del mundo. Es difícil imaginar que una pequeña empresa de riego pueda volver a tener tanta influencia sobre una comunidad como esta.
The folks in Rio Rico today, they know little if nothing of the history of Rio Rico.
Look at the sheds or almost everything falling apart, you know, it's just like, maybe it's hard to believe that it was like a very active town.
That river doesn't separate people. We're still brothers. We're still, you know, we're all just people.
So that's my story about Rio Rico, one town, two countries, and the lost Americans.